sir. Now you are audible, pretty audible, sir. You can start.
Okay, thank you. I'm again thankful to Dr. Ashok Rathod ji and the Icon Services for inviting me as a chairperson for today's session of this webinar series on environmental protection. The theme of today's session is water management in mines, and the plenary lecture will be delivered by the guest speaker, Dr. Kumkum Mishra. Water is the main natural economic source for human survival. Water plays an important role in sanitation for our rural and urban communities. It is also necessary for all forms of agriculture and most of the industrial production processes. Water also provides a wide range of ecosystem and environmental services. However, due to various factors such as population growth and economic development, the availability of water is becoming increasingly constrained in many areas. The growing of water scarcity problems impose a serious threat to ecosystem management, social sustainability, and economic growth. At this point, I would like to share this proactive comment from the renowned water leader, Professor Asit Vishwas. There is no scarcity of water, only a scarcity of management. Therefore, water management is the need of time. Water resource management mainly deals with the activity of planning, developing, distributing, and managing the optimum use of water resources. Today's presentation is mainly related to the management aspects of water in relation to mining sector. Broadly speaking, there are different methods through which management of water can be done, such as rainwater harvesting, natural as well as artificial groundwater recharge, drip irrigation, sewage water treatment, desalination, etc. Some other best water management practices also include metering and measurement of water, optimization of cooling towers, reuse of laboratory culture water, controlled reverse osmosis system operation, etc. As far as mining sector is concerned, water plays an essential role in most mining and extractive processes. Mines require water. At the same time, because many mine working areas are below the water table, removal of water is a major challenge. Therefore, responsible water use is a critical business issue that affects the ability of individual mines to establish, operate, and close. Communities close to mine sites may be concerned about availability of water, security of their access to it, and the potential for water contamination. In mining operations, the most important use of water is typically in mineral processing. Water is required in hydrometallurgical processes, for example, to recover gold and copper from a solution of chemicals. Water is also required in pyrometallurgical processes, for example, in platinum and copper production, for cooling and other parts of the process. Significant amount of water may also be needed for dust control on hauled roads and waste dumps. This water can be lower quality industrial water or mine water, provided there are no contamination risks. In contrast, high quality potable water is required for domestic purpose in the office and administrative buildings and in camps associated with remote mines. A proper water management system can be beneficial to the mine. If the planning of water balance management actions has already been started in the early phases of the mine's life cycle, several advantages can be gained. Good environmental performance also increases the social acceptance of the mine. I will request the organizers to introduce our speaker, Dr. Kumkum Mishra, and invite her to highlight various aspects of water management pertaining to mines. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for a word of wisdom on the water and its importance, management in various sectors. And now we have speaker, Dr. Kumkum Mishra, for delivering her talk on water management in mining industry. She is an environmental consultant, and also she is running one firm, Aviral Solution. Basically, the Aviral Solution for water and its management in various sectors. She did MPhil and PhD in environmental science from HNB Garhwal University, and she did MSc in environmental science from Gurukul Kangri University, Haridwar, and PG Diploma in Disaster Management from IGNU. She has been also awarded for Young Scientist Award from Department of Science and Technology, DST, Government of Uttarakhand. She has attended around 30 conferences, workshop, training program. She has also published more than 25 research items in reputed international nation journals. She has around 12 years of experience in research and consultancy. Related to water resource conservation management, groundwater availability, sustainability management, hydrological studies, environmental studies, impact assessment study, remote sensing and GIS technologies. The rainwater harvesting, artificial rainwater harvesting practices. She also engaged as a reviewer for various reputed international journals. Now I invite our guest speaker, Dr. Kumkum Mishra, to deliver her talk on water management in mining industry. Over to Dr. Kumkum Mishra. Can you hear me, Dr. Mishra? Now you can share from your side. Dr. Kumkum Mishra, can you hear me? Am I audible, right? Hello, Dr. Kumkum Mishra.
Sir, she will have to unmute her mic.
I think,
She has done.
Yeah. Hello, can you hear me, Dr. Mishra? Dr. Kumkum, can you hear me? Okay, I think some issues are there. I am just going to share from my side only. One minute. Yeah, okay. Speak loudly, your voice is not coming this side, Dr. Kumkum Mishra. Yeah, your slide is visible. Can you hear me, right? You are not audible, Dr. Kumkum Mishra. Can you speak loudly? Some technical issues are there. You can, your mic is muted, yeah. You are not audible.
She is audible, literally she was audible, sir, for one second.
Okay.
Dr. Kumkum Mishra, please speak loudly so that we can hear it. Hello, Dr. Kumkum Mishra, is there any problem from your side?
No problem, I'm waiting for a voice.
Yeah, yeah, please speak loudly so that we can hear. We can hear only very low voice. No, 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 madam, not clearly.
Speak loudly near to the mic. I think some issue with the mic, right? Otherwise, you can do one thing. Yeah, you can do one thing. You can just log out and join again. I think some issues has happened at the timing of join.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Till now, we introduce about this water management in the mines. As we know, water is of basically two type, as per their containment, like surface water, or second is the ground water. Sometime the water, surface water, if it is in the sea, then that water is termed as a marine water. So basically we have two type of water which can be potable and can be make it to potable, like surface water from the rivers, from the lake, from the pond, etc. So this surface water can be diverted for some purposes like irrigation.
Hello?
Yeah. Your Hello? Voice is audible now. Yes, yes. You are pretty audible
okay,
now.
Okay.
Just start
yeah.
sharing.
Okay, okay. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. So in between, and the groundwater, it of course it is available freely, and everyone is using the groundwater. So now our speaker is there. She will present about the management of water in mining industry. So what?
Sir, my, sir,
yeah,
my,
your
is
presentation
is visible.
Yeah, and you are also audible
yeah.
now. Very pretty audible.
Yeah.
You can start now, please, ma'am.
Okay, sir. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, thank you, Dr. Rathore, for this platform giving me, and Dr. Vipin Atwal for describing the subject very precisely, all the advisory committee members, panelists, and all the participants. So starting from the current topic, that is mine, water management. Basically, the current topic will be discussed under major heads, that is mine dewatering, sources of water in mines, control practices, regulatory process, with special reference to Ministry of Environment, Forest, and Climate Change. And this is mine dewatering. What is mine dewatering? Mine dewatering is basically the process of controlling and managing groundwater as well as surface water to improve the efficiency, mining methods, and to ensure that mining operations must be continued without any hindrance and to allow mining in relatively dry conditions. What is groundwater seepage? This is very much important to know what is basically groundwater seepage. When we what is mining? When we excavate or open the ground surface for the purpose of extracting some minerals, ores, or some other valuable materials, that is basically mining. And from some very common material that are extracted from mines, that is limestone, marble, granite, phosphate, coal, rubble stone, some metal ores like copper, iron, gold, silver, etc., uranium. So when a mine is operated or extended below the water level, general groundwater level in the area, water inflow occurs from the surrounding layers as a result of gravity towards the active mining excavation. This is known as groundwater seepage, and this is resulting from water level excavation in the area. As it is very clear from this picture, this is the rainfall falling over excavated mine. This is the surface runoff. Collecting and entering the mining pit. This is the water table in that area, and we have done mining below this water table, so groundwater seepage is occurring from the surrounding layers. And in this picture, it is very clear. You can say this groundwater is seeping into excavated mine pit. See here and here. It is below second or third bench. The water is seeping into the excavated mine pits. Before proceeding further about water management in mines, we must know what are the basic sources of water in mine. There are basically two sources, that is surface water or groundwater. How surface water is entering? There are basically in two ways. First, the rainfall or precipitation directly falling onto the active excavated mine pits, or second is the surface runoff from the surrounding areas. as per the surface gradient to the active mining pits. Similarly, groundwater entering through surrounding layers as seepage and into accepted mine pits. So there are basically two methods for control for surface water as well as groundwater. Surface water, suppose if water is falling directly, that is precipitation. That is what we do, basically store the water in the lower benches of excavated mine pit. And if this is surface, as coming as surface runoff towards the mine pit, we divert it to the distant place by the ways of collector drains, barland drains, or some ditches and some etc. Similarly, for groundwater, either we allow water to enter the pit and is stored in the lower benches or as some, or we exclude the water before entering the pit by adopting appropriate technology. And this water, which is stored and collected in some, that is pumped out. And either it is used for beneficial uses, either on-site in project activities, mining activities, or off-site, that is nearby communities, villages, or for other purposes. Environmental mitigation, that is for groundwater recharge, rising the water levels through rainwater harvesting, or it is disposed of to natural water courses, surface water bodies nearby. So these are the some photographs of mine sump. You can see a large quantity of water is stored in excavated mine pits. Mine dewatering. Basically, there are three important aspects if we design and implement mine dewatering. First is the hydrogeology of the area. We must know some basic terminologies about groundwater and the parameters that govern the groundwater flow within mine. So starting from groundwater, water that lies beneath the ground surface, and it fills the pore space between soil particles, grains, sedimentary rock, and cracks and the openings in all types of rock. And basic source of groundwater is rain and snow. Apart of that, rain generally percolates down and joins the subsurface aquifer, and a part, rest part, joins the subsurface flow. What is water table? Basically, reaching the water table, there are two zones below the subsurface. One is unsaturated and saturated. This unsaturated zone, also known as Beddoes zone, and the saturated zone, this is also known as Freated zone. In this unsaturated zone, the top surface is Beddoes zone, where soil particles are partially filled with water as well as air. Then this capillary fringe area comes. This is a transition zone where moisture content is relatively high. This is a saturated zone where soil particles or the rock openings are completely filled with water. And this top layer of this saturated zone is known as water table, lithological control. Basically, you know, there are rocks or the geological formations are divided into three major groups, that is igneous rocks, that are formed through cooling and solidification of lava, sedimentary rocks formed by deposition of material at their surface, and the metamorphic rocks that are transformed, that arise from transformation of existing rocks by the application of high pressure temperature, like gneiss, marble, quartzite, phyllite. But if we are concerned with respect to groundwater storage, movement, and yield, these rocks can be broadly classified as consolidated, like granite, basalt, gneiss, and schist, semi-consolidated, like sandstone, shale, and limestone, and unconsolidated, like boulder, gravel, sand, and sand, silt, and clay. These unconsolidated rocks basically include the non-indurated sediments of fluvial, aeolian, lacustrine, glacial, or marine origin. Movement of groundwater. Most of the groundwater moves relatively slowly underground, and groundwater moves generally in response to differences in water pressure and elevation. You know, it's a water basically flows high elevation to lower elevation, high water pressure to low water pressure. So within upper part of the saturated zone, it moves downward following the slope of the water. Also, two major factors that are governing movement of groundwater are slope of water table. The steeper the water slope, faster the groundwater movement will be. And permeability, of course, if openings are small, poorly connected, water flows free, and when these openings are large, well-connected, flow water is comparatively more rapid. Then comes Darcy law. Darcy law, you can consider a base law or the governing equation for any of the porous media where a rate of flow of water is considered. Here, this Q is flow rate through the porous media, water flow rate. And this is directly proportional to cross-section area of aquifer exposed. and directly proportional to hydraulic gradient. This hydraulic gradient I is further divided into H1 minus H2 upon L. These H1 and H2 are the hydraulic heads at the two ends of water column. And this K is proportionality constant, which we termed as hydraulic conductivity or permeability of an aquifer. You can see here these porous media. This is the length of column or the length of porous media. These H1 is the height of water column at this point, and H2 is height of water column at this point. So basically, it governs all the equation, whether it is in any groundwater modeling software. This is the basic law that is governing the flow rate in porous media. Hydraulic conductivity, that is, there are basically two or three major parameters that you must know. Hydraulic conductivity of aquifer, transmissivity, that is that will be discussed further, and storage coefficient and specific yield of an aquifer. Hydraulic conductivity, basically it is the capability of a porous medium or the aquifer medium to transmit water. Again, it is the Darcy law equation. This is Q is equal to Ka, where K is the hydraulic conductivity or permeability of an aquifer. And hydraulic conductivity varies widely from clay, massive igneous rocks to sand, gravel, and vesicular cavernous limestone dolomite, generally expressed in feet per day or meter per day, and varies for 10 to 10,000 meter per day from fine sand to limestone and dolomite. Transmissivity. Hydraulic conductivity is basically medium or capability of porous medium to transmit water. But transmissivity is basically if there is thickness of 10 meter of aquifer that is saturated, then transmissivity comes this hydraulic conductivity into thickness of aquifer. So basically it is rate of flow of water per unit width to entire thickness. Entire thickness can be 10 meter, 20 meter, 40 meter, whatever, through an aquifer per unit hydraulic gradient. Porosity. Porosity, basically what is porosity? This is ratio of void space to the total volume of soil or rock. Or what we can say, this is the space available for water molecules to be stored within soil particles or the rock openings. So the space available will be basically porosity. Higher the porosity, higher the quantity of water to be stored in different geological formations. Here you can see the types of porous media. These are soil. This is gravels or boulders. This is gravels with some finer particles like fine sand, or these are gravels with the finer clay and silt material. Here the porous media in hard rock, basically it is in the forms of fractures or rock openings. Sometimes it is unconnected, and sometimes it is pretty connected with other rock openings. And of course, porosity varies from material to material, gravel, sand, you can see sand, higher porosity. Similarly, if there is granite or rubble weathered, it porosity comes up to 40%. And then specific yield. Specific yield is basically the capability of a medium or the yield of an aquifer. So specific yield we consider when we consider unconfined. Aquifer are basically of two types, confined and unconfined. Unconfined, which is in direct contact with the atmosphere, and confined, that is trapped below in impermeable layer. So in unconfined aquifer, water moves down as a result of gravity, while in confined aquifer, it is stored under pressure. So when we talk about the yield of an aquifer that is unconfined, that is specific yield. This is basically the water that an unconfined aquifer will release from storage or take on into storage as a result of gravity. It is also expressed in percentage or decimal fraction. The storage coefficient, I already told you, when we consider the confined aquifer, the capability or yield of an aquifer is the storage coefficient and amount of water that it will release due to any saturated aquifer per unit surface area. Generally, storage coefficient is very less, 10 to the power minus 4 to the 10 to the power minus 5. You know, basically how we calculate in a basic way the dewatering volume in a mine pit. Basically, this is the dynamic resources, which is indirect, which is changing as per the rainfall and recharge every year. So these are basically dynamic resources, rainfall interception that is falling onto open excavated pits, and the groundwater seepage that is coming from the surrounding layers. So it is, for example, suppose area of a mine is suppose is 125,000 rainfall. Higher rainfall in that area is 1500 mm, and lower rainfall is up to 1000 mm. So rainwater volume that is received in the pit will be rainfall in meter area and meter square, and the rainfall coefficient. Rainfall coefficient generally taken 90% at the time of rainfall in humid regions, but if it is arid regions, we generally consider rainfall coefficient 0.8, as some evaporation takes place even when it is raining. Then groundwater seepage is calculated. How it is calculated? Length of aquifer. Length of aquifer, suppose we have a pit 500 meter in length and 200 meter in width. So length of aquifer exposed will be length and width of the pit across the groundwater flow direction. Hydraulic conductivity, we already discussed, suppose it is limestone, this is 10 meter per day. Hydraulic gradient means in one kilometer, there is difference in water level elevation is 10 meter. This is hydraulic gradient, basically per kilometer or per unit, and the difference in water level elevations we consider is 0.01. Saturated thickness is basically, suppose water level in any area is 10 meters below ground level, and we go mining up to depth of 30 meter. So saturated thickness will be 30 minus 10 is equal to 20 meter will be exposed. So lateral flow, basically groundwater seepage, will be multiplying all those, that is coming 1400 cubic meter per day. And we consider the groundwater seepage per annum. We consider 1400 into 365, and these values are expressed in MCM for the ease of calculation. So total volume intercepted will be rainwater volume and the groundwater seepage. If high rainfall, about 0.72, and in case of low rainfall, this water will be stored in the excavated mine pits. Then comes the dewatering technologies. As we already told, there are two sources of water in the mine pits. One is surface water and groundwater. Few approaches surface water control are, if we talk about the surface runoff, that is coming the surrounding area into mine pit, we intercept that runoff before entering the pit. What we do, we make bunds of natural soil or the excavated material, and make the garland and collector drains, some ditches and some or the settling tanks, and store the surface runoff before entering the pit around the perimeter of pits. You can see here the garland drains. This side is mining pit. This is Kracha garland drain. Here some stone pitching type garland, and this is what our garland drain. And other source of surface water is that is direct falling onto excavated pits. So we have to store in the lower benches or the sump, and that is a temporary store for storm water. And what we do, that water is pumped out from the mine at a distance place, and some basic water treatment is to be carried out. Suppose in basic, if we store that water in large surface tanks or rainwater harvesting ponds, some solids are settled down, some coagulation, flocculation, filtration, disinfection are carried out as per the requirement and purpose for disposal. And then it supplies water, it is for project activities or for drinking purposes. So process of treatment will be according to that. Then groundwater control. Groundwater control is basically two main approaches. First is by pumping. By pumping, we used in-pit pumping, yeah, in-pit pumps, and perimeter walls to lower the groundwater levels. And groundwater control by exclusion, we generally use physical cutoff walls to exclude groundwater from the excavation. Again, in-pit pumping, we used pumps that are submersible or suction from sump areas within the pit. Perimeter dewatering walls we use to intercept lateral groundwater flow into the pit to lower groundwater levels before started of mining or in advance of mining. Pit slope depressurization drains. Horizontal drains are used to provide permeable pathways to allow trapped or slowly draining groundwater behind the pit slopes. This is in pit pumping. In pit pumping, water is stored in the lower benches or the sump area. Air pumps are located within the deeper parts of the pit. Submersible or suction pumps are used. If pits are deeper, more than 50 or 60 meters, some booster pumps need to be applied to lift the water from the pit. And advantage is flexible in use, means additional pumps, if there is more seepage or less seepage, additional pumps may be added or removed. or and but some two or three disadvantages also there, like we have to construct some drains or ditches here, and then to transfer this water seeping from different branches to the some. So presence of these features may interfere with mining operations, and water produced from this in pit pumping may have some significant sediment content, and therefore some treatment by settlement lagoons and etc. Here you can see the suction pumps, and submersible pumps are also there to pump out water from the mine. Perimeter dewatering walls here. Vertical walls or vertical wells or bore wells are installed around the periphery or the active pit area, and pumps. These pumps are basically electric submersible pumps, or these are installed across the groundwater flow direction into the active pit. These wells to be located as per the structural geology and aquifer characteristics. One advantage is once we develop those wells, they produce clean water, so water treatment requirements are minimum. And disadvantage, you can say, if the pit is going deep or the deeper pits, the cost per well is comparatively high. So water is in advance being pumped and water level is lowered, so no water can come inside the pit, and there is basically streamline mining in this case. Here you can see by this picture, this is the depth of mining pit. This is mining pit. Original groundwater level is there. We installed these perimeter dewatering wells, and they lower the groundwater level below the maximum depth of pit, and for a smooth functioning of mining. Pit slope depressurization schemes. Here some in-pit in-pit pumping or these perimeter walls are already deployed, but some high pore pressure may remain in the pit slopes, which reduces the geotechnical stability. So basically we achieved this by small diameter. This is a small diameter angle or subangular horizontal drains, which are drilled outside through the pit slopes. And these drains act as pressure relief wells and bleed off the water by gravity. This water is collected in drains and ditches and finally fed to the in-pit pumps. Physical cutoff walls. Here is another method, however, very applied in very special cases. These physical cutoff walls are installed around a mine pit to exclude groundwater from the shallow permeable strata. Or to seal off preferential flow along the permeable strata. Basically, you can see what. Suppose this is, these cutoff walls are constructed in permeable zone or the shallow permeable zone. You can see this is low permeable strata. This is the original water table. We make these cutoff walls. These aquifer is cut down and water seeps into this trench. And generally, this trench, the excavated barriers or the filling material is soil bentonite slurry walls. If the depth is 25 meter, and if more depth up to 60 meter, the soil cement bentonite wall is used, and this collected water is pumped outside. And this the width of this cutoff walls is basically 30 to 100 centimeter. You can say 3 feet, 2.5 to 3 feet max. And this bentonite, this soil bentonite slurry bentonite, is basically an absorbent swelling clay that is used. And further, these open one another method that is used is well point system. A well point system basically contains, you can see, a series of small diameter wells that are installed by water jetting, rotary drilling, or augmenting technology. It is connected by a header pipe that is further connected to a centrally located suction pump, and this single, these are basically in single well stage point or the multiple stage well points. Single well stage point system is applied when this depth of excavation is 4.5 meter to max, and if the depth of excavation is more, up to 15 meter, multiple stage well point system is applied, and excavation is carried out to stabilize granular soils. To generally, what we do if we pump out the water in a certain way, the soil or the permeable stratum granular soil collapses down. So to prevent this, we pump the water in different stages as per the requirement. And this method is basically useful apart from mining. This is useful in buildings, basement construction, deep sewer lines, tunnel work, water supply projects, underground tank construction, etc. This is one again method. This is O drainage and drainage audits and tunnels. This audit is basically a horizontal tunnel for drainage mine, and this audit level is can be deep or shallow, and generally at the lowest level from which water can be drained out. And this the water is stored in this tunnel are pumped out from a vertical well. Then environmental sensitivity or the impact of dewatering. Few certain impacts are foreseen as declining groundwater levels in surrounding areas. Definitely groundwater levels go down if groundwater seepage occurs in the area, and as the shallow water table, as the shallow water levels, water seeps down, it is very common that water will be declining, reduced or eliminated production in domestic supply wells. Yes, you know, domestic wells, either for drinking purpose or for agriculture purpose, they are shallow depth. So if water table is declining, these wells go dry and out of order. Reduction or elimination of surface water flows. Yes, you can understand this by this method. Am I audible? Hello?
You are audible. Please, can you complete within next 2, 3, 5 minutes? Because this is going to...
I'm trying.
Yeah, please.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you can join.
Sir, I will try, but I will finish it already. So you can basically is surface water flows. How? In humid regions, or you can see the hard rock areas, stream beds are usually wet, but how? Generally, these areas, rainfall is frequently high. So if water table is high and this streams go dry, these are generally non-perennial, you can say, and flows for a few months only. In non-perennial season or lean season, this high groundwater table, from this high groundwater table, water flows in the stream and maintaining this base flow. But if this groundwater table goes down, and in when storm flow in the channel, this water infiltrates down and further reducing the water availability in surface water courses. Degradation of surface water quality, yes. Some pollutants, if we say that coal mining, yes, there are some heavy metals, other mining, high sediment silt load is there in pumped out water. And if this is if the direct runoff goes into the surrounding water courses, or the pumped out water is disposed of as such in the surrounding water courses, water quality degraded. And if the local community is using, definitely this water cannot be used for further purposes. Seawater intrusion or aquifer degradation. This is a very important point. Just a second. Yes, you can understand seawater seawater. Generally, the mining projects located in coastal areas, it is very important to understand whether there will be water table intersection or the groundwater seepage in the mining due to mining activities. Basically, what is saltwater intrusion? Saltwater intrusion is induced flow of seawater into freshwater aquifers, primarily caused by groundwater development near the coast. What is if this seawater is in hydraulic connection with the aquifers, and if there is over pumping, the migration of salt water from the seawater towards a well, this fresh water is basically unusable. Here, given a GH equation works out, GH relation, we can say that is for every unit of fresh water. For every unit of groundwater above sea level, suppose it is 1 meter above sea level, the depth of water, there will be 40 units of fresh water below the sea level. And if there is a decline in 1 meter in the fresh water level, 40 times the seawater will be moved towards the freshwater aquifers. So here and why this happens? Because salt water has a higher density than freshwater, so pressure under a column of seawater is greater than the pressure under an equivalent volume of freshwater. So if there is some mining activity in coastal areas and we pump out the mine some water, the groundwater, if the 1 meter there is definitely cone of depression will be happen. And this, if it this is happen 1 meter, 40 times seawater moves toward the freshwater aquifers and deteriorates the water quality. Degradation of habitats in riparian zones. What are riparian zones? Basically, these are the plant habitats and communities along river marges. And these riparian zones are important natural biofilters, protecting aquatic environments from excessive sedimentation,